meetings at 10 o'clock on
13th.
January 13th. So we'll be back at 10 o'clock on Thursdays on January 13th. But it sure has been fun to do this in the Sunday morning slot for these last couple of weeks. We're going to be working on Luke chapters 1 and 2 today. We have handouts in the back. We also have copies of the Bible, but you can work from your own text as well. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let's pray. Almighty God, your Holy Spirit refuses to be contained, and your love knows no bounds. Thank you for sending among us John the Baptist and our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for the faithful witnesses of Elizabeth and Mary and Zechariah and Joseph. Grant that as we hear these familiar stories once again, we will be inspired to serve you in our day as they did in theirs. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
So for those of you who were not here last week, we did a pretty deep dive into the first chapter of St. Luke's Gospel. In the opening paragraph, we get the dedication of the Gospel, which is to a man with a Greek-sounding name, and his name is?
Theophilus.
Theophilus. In Luke chapter 1, the Gospel is dedicated to Theophilus, which derives from two Greek root words, theos and philia, which means God and love. So the Gospel of Luke is addressed to the lovers of God. In other words, the Gospel of Luke is addressed to us. And Luke tells us that his purpose is to organize all of these different ideas and themes that have come together and put them together in an orderly fashion so that we, the lovers of God, can know the truth. Now, if I were to give you a little sample of text and say this text is from one of the Gospels, and if that text involved the word immediately, which Gospel would that most likely be from?
Mark,
exactly. Immediately, things are happening in Mark. It's a very action-packed, quick, short Gospel. Immediately, if you're asked, is probably giving away Mark. If I said in that little snippet of Gospel text that it includes the phrase, as it is written, we're most likely going to be in
Matthew,
written for a Jewish audience, fulfilling the Holy Scriptures. If I gave you a little snippet of text, and this is a trick, I didn't give it to you last week, and it says, Jesus said, I am in it. What Gospel are we working in?
John.
All of the I ams are in John. But here we are in Luke, and the key phrase for Luke, and if you spot it, you can say, okay, I'm probably working in Luke, or Luke's second volume, which is the Acts of the Apostles, is the Holy Spirit. Luke uses the phrase Holy Spirit far more often than any of the other Gospel writers, showing that he is concerned about the way that God is continuing to reveal himself and unfold his purpose in the world. We run into the phrase Holy Spirit only 15 verses in Luke chapter 1, and the first person that the first time we hear about it is when Zechariah is being told that his wife Elizabeth, even in her old age, is going to have a child, and that child, John the Baptist, is going to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, a funny thing happens to Zechariah, and I'm just giving you the quick reminder so we have this dusted off as we pick up. A funny thing happens to Zechariah. He's a priest of the temple. He goes into the Holy of Holies, and there in that sacred place is an angel, and he's terrified. And the angel says, don't be afraid, repeated phrase. Most repeated phrase in all of Holy Scripture, Old Testament and New, do not be afraid. The angel says, don't be afraid. Zechariah says, you're going to have a son. Zechariah says, you're crazy. You are crazy. My wife is old, my wife is barren, this ain't going to happen. This is casting us back to when Sarah learns that she's going to have a baby, and she literally falls on the ground laughing because it's so ridiculous. And then Zechariah, something happens to him because he doubted the angel, and what happens to him?
Mute.
He is struck mute, and we're going to resolve that in just a second. But he is struck mute, so he can't tell people what's going on. He has to sort of gesture or write or do something that's going to convey this wonderful story. Then Elizabeth does become pregnant, and when she is in her sixth month, Her cousin Mary, who has just had another visit from the same angel and been told that she is going to be filled with the Holy Spirit, and she will bear a son, and his name will be Jesus, she goes to visit Elizabeth. And when, by the way, this is the gospel reading for today, so you can be good listeners when you're in church in just a minute. Mary walks into Elizabeth's house, and what happens then? John the Baptist leaps in her womb, and Elizabeth is filled with the Holy Spirit. So not only is John the Baptist going to be filled with the Holy Spirit, but Elizabeth becomes filled with the Holy Spirit before John the Baptist is even out of her womb. The Holy Spirit will not be contained. The Holy Spirit will not be contained. A few weeks ago, we had the Episcopal bishop in charge of the Convocation of Episcopal Churches in Europe as a guest preacher and lecturer. And those of you who were at the 8 o'clock service would have heard a story that he told. And he said he was preaching on Christ the King Sunday. And he said, it's appropriate that I'm here to preach on Christ the King because many of the congregations of which I am the bishop are located in kingdoms. And I recently received a letter from the King of Belgium, inviting me to a reception honoring the 150th anniversary of the recognition of the Anglican Church by the King of Belgium. I don't get letters like that, but you know, it's all right. But he went on to say that the King of Belgium is a constitutional monarch. Power is prescribed by the Constitution and checked by the Parliament and all these things. And he went on to make the point, the reign of Christ is not a constitutional monarch. The Holy Spirit will not be contained and limited. And what we have in Luke's gospel, starting with these pregnancies, is the Holy Spirit busting out everywhere. We also have the model that when Jesus shows up, the Holy Spirit gets active. And we see that in the visitation. Jillian, please.
Dr. Stagg always said that Luke Acts was recording the search for an unhindered gospel.
Unhindered gospel, I love that. Luke in Acts is recording the search for an unhindered gospel. The gospel, of course, means good news in Greek. It's its literal translation. And so unhindered, meaning the good news of God is spreading out without bounds.
And that's why it ends with Paul in Rome preaching quite unhindered.
Yes, we're preaching quite unhindered. Indeed, it doesn't really have an ending. We don't know what happens to Paul at the end. Wonderful.
It's not important.
It's not important. And I'm going to come back to that point in just one second. So we finished up at with Mary's Song of Praise, which is Luke chapter 1, verses 46 to 56. We commented on the Magnificat, which is so common and familiar to all of us, and starts off so gentle, my soul magnifies the Lord, my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. But even Mary knows what's going to happen next. Even Mary knows, and in her song he says, God has shown strength, he has scattered the proud, he has brought down the powerful, he's lifted up the lowly, he's filled the hungry, and he sent the rich away empty. This Jesus person is going to turn the world on its head. It's going to end the corrupt ways of the world and bring us to the kingdom of God. And that's where we ended last week. We begin today in Luke chapter 1 and verse 57 with the birth of John the Baptist. By the way, I should mention all these headings that you see are not part of Scripture. Right? They're added by editors. And in fact, the chapter and verse numbers didn't start appearing until around the Middle Ages. If you look at the original text, it's all just straight text running through. So all of this is just editors helping us out, but we can disagree with their headings if we want to.
The Greek did not even have marks of punctuation.
No punctuation.
Separation between words.
Just long strings of letters that you have to go and figure out. So thank God for translators, right? All right, the birth of John the Baptist, chapter 1 and verse 57. Now the time came for Elizabeth to give birth, and she bore a son. Her neighbors and relatives heard that the Lord had shown his great mercy to her, and they rejoiced with her. On the eighth day they came to circumcise the child, and they were going to name him Zechariah after his father. But his mother said, "No, he is to be called John." And they said to her, "None of your relatives has this name." And they began motioning to his father to figure out what name he wanted to give him. He asked for a writing tablet. Why?
He's mute.
He asked for a writing tablet, and he writes, "His name is John." And all of them were amazed. Immediately his mouth was open, his tongue was freed, and he began to speak, praising God. Fear came over all the neighbors, and all these things were talked about through the entire hill country of Judea. And all who heard them, pondered them, and said, "What then will this child become?" But indeed, the hand of the Lord was with him. All right, let's just grab the facts. This is a great scene. So we remember Zechariah is in the temple. He's told about John's coming. He doubts it. He's struck mute. They have this wonderful interchange between Mary and Elizabeth. The child is born. The time comes for him to be circumcised. The time comes for him to be presented in the temple. Dad is mute. And so all of the people of the temple, being good neighbors and such, say, "Well, we'll name this child for you. And surely you want to name him for his father, don't you?" And she said, "His name's John." And he said, "Well, that can't be right. That so can't be right. You name firstborn sons, particularly one you've waited for so long, you name them for the father. Let's ask the father. Surely he'll go and clarify this. Zechariah, come over here. Your wife, she wants to name this child John." And Zechariah, still mute, takes a chalkboard and writes, "His name is John." In my own family, we have we like Roman numerals after our names. Those of you who've seen my email signature know that I have a Roman numeral too. The longest stretch we've gotten in our family to date is a 4. J.F. Webb IV, and that person had a son who is not the 5th. And I asked him once, "How did you make that decision?" He said, "His mom told me that's not what was going to happen." And I said, "Well, that makes good sense. It was as simple as that." So we get the baby presented, we get the baby's name, and immediately, almost as though Mark were writing this story, immediately, after Zechariah writes, "His name is John," not, you know, "God told me that he kind of wanted a name John, but I really like a Zechariah Jr." None of that. His name is John. As soon as he writes it on the page, his mouth is open. He can finally tell the story. And the first thing that comes out of his mouth is this, continuing to read in 67. "And then his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke this prophecy, 'Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, for he has looked favorably on his people and redeemed them. He has raised up for us a mighty Savior in the house of his servant David, as he spoke through the mouth of his holy prophets of old, that we would be saved from our enemies and from the hands of all who hate us. Thus he has shown the mercy he promised to our ancestors and has remembered his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our father Abraham, to grant us that we, being rescued from the hands of our enemies, might serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the forgiveness of their sins. By the tender mercy of our God, the dawn from on high will break upon us to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace." And the child grew and became strong in spirit, and he was in the wilderness until the day he appeared publicly to Israel. Zechariah's tongue is freed, and the first thing that comes out of his mouth, "Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel." Praise. He is overwhelmed. His heart is so filled and so convicted that he can do nothing but say, "How great my God is." Not a bad discipline for us. When we look around and we see all of the things that God has done for us and given us, to respond not with a request for more, maybe not even direct thanks, but just joy. "Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, for he has looked favorably on his people." He can't contain himself. He's filled with the Holy Spirit, it says in verse 67. This is like the fourth or fifth person who's gotten filled with the Holy Spirit in the space of one chapter. He's filled with that energy. And then he looks at this child. One of the privileges of my work is getting to be with people in the hospital when they bear babies, and to go and see them looking at their child and saying, wow, particularly a first child, what is this? What has happened? What identity change has just taken place? And he looks at his child and he says, you're going to be the prophet of the Most High. You're going to preach hope to people by offering them forgiveness. You're going to tell them they don't have to carry all that around with them any longer. They can let it go. You're going to tell them that the dawn is about to break and a new day is coming in which there will be no darkness. Looking on the face of his child, he sees the hope that has been promised by God and that has filled his soul from the Holy Spirit. Jillian,
verses 76 and 77 give the entire theology of John.
Oh, interesting point. Jillian's drawing our attention to 76 and 77 as a summary text of the theology that John is preaching. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, identifying him as the prophet to come. You'll go before the Lord to prepare his ways. We hear that in John's own recitation later. And then his purpose, to give the knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of sins. I'd like to pause and just think for a moment on forgiveness of sins. I think we're conditioned to think of sins as actions, as things, and the things that are attached to, have guilt attached to them. This is something I should not have done. This is something I should have done. This is something that society tells me I should have done, or my parents tell me I should have done, or my spouse tells me I should have done, or my children tell me I should have done. All of the expectations of the world, or God tells me I should have done, all those expectations are resting on us. And when we fall short of them, we experience this guilt and this heaviness. And what Zechariah says of Jesus' ministry in 77 is to give knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of sin. To give knowledge of new life. To say that we can be free from all of that by the forgiveness of sin. The tool that God is using is offering forgiveness so that we can live our fullest and best lives. In pastoral care, as I have conversations with people, it's often, the challenge is often laying down the suitcases. I've acknowledged that this didn't go the way it needed to. I've acknowledged my role in this. I've acknowledged that I had a role in this going in this way. And I've heard that God forgives me. I've heard the priest say, this is what God took to the cross. I've heard that. But now I actually have to leave it and walk on. That can be really hard. I invite you to think about what suitcases you might be carrying around at the moment. Old hurts, old things, long since passed, long since forgiven either by God or by other people. What invitation Zechariah gives us in saying Jesus' ministry is to let us lay that down. I've told this story before in the forum and in sermons that one of the most powerful spiritual things that was ever said to me, I was with a very wise priest who was one of my theology professors, and I was laying out for her all of the challenges that were going on in whatever career it was, whatever point in my career it was. Just all of these things, and what if I do this, and what if I don't do that, what if I don't get it right? And she sat there quietly, and then she looked at me and said, Sandy, Jesus died that you might be free. And yet I hear in your voice only a spirit of slavery. How often do we miss that? The whole point of what God did in Jesus Christ is our freedom. Put a technical word on that, our salvation, our liberation. That's the point. You will offer them forgiveness of their sins and make them aware that they can live free and liberated lives. That is the point of the coming of Christ as Luke and John understand it. Anything else? me 1 second to look back. The place that we would see it with regard to Jesus is in the Annunciation to Mary.
So Mary has shared with Elizabeth and probably him as well what she knows. I just wonder, it sounds like they already know how this is all going to end.
I think that's a pretty safe assumption, yes.
Okay.
I'm not finding exactly the reference, but I think that we can assume that. I think also the idea of atonement through death would have been running through the cultural and religious understanding of that day. So I think that's a pretty good assumption to make. And both for John the Baptist and for Jesus, prophets don't tend to have good outcomes when they're preaching about the downfall of things. It's interesting to me that the Song of Zechariah is written in the future tense, and the Song of Mary is written in the past tense. So Mary sees it as something accomplished. This has happened. The lowly have been brought up, the powerful have been brought down, but Zechariah is running it in the future tense, where we will see you will go before the Lord to prepare his way. You will offer knowledge of salvation. You will give light to those who sit in darkness. So we have two different approaches. Verse 80 confuses me, and I'm just going to own that. I'm not quite sure why he was in the wilderness until the day that he appears publicly in Israel, other than that it gives an explanation of why he was coming out of the wilderness. But what I want to put, Jillian.
My theory is that John brings his audience into the wilderness, and then on the theory that they have violated the covenant upon which they were given the land of Israel.
Oh, that's a really interesting observation.
And so when they repent of their sins, they go through the Jordan and re-enter the promised land with their sins forgiven.
What Jillian just offered was that John and his followers and disciples may have left the promised land, which, remember, possession of the land is the symbol of faithfulness. And so if we take folks who are being acknowledged to be unfaithful back into the wilderness, then they can re-enter the promised land with their faithfulness coming through the Jordan. Remember, the Jordan River is the dividing line between the wilderness on one hand, right now what would be part of the kingdom of Jordan, and the promised land on the other side, right now part of the state of Israel. So passing through the Jordan to the wilderness and then passing back into the promised land. It's a good observation. What I do want to draw our attention to, though, is that we get no detail on how John the Baptist was raised. Hardly any information at all. We're going to see a similar presentation about Jesus. Very little information. In fact, Luke is the only one who gives us any information about Jesus' upbringing. And as Jillian said earlier, that's telling us what Luke thinks is important. What Luke thinks is important is the circumstances under which John the Baptist and Jesus enter the picture. The faithfulness of their parents, the way that the Holy Spirit is moving, that's what's important.
From John, the heart of Jewish piety to the whole Roman world.
Say it again, John.
From the heart of Jewish piety to the whole Roman world.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Luke is definitely seeing all of this expanding out. What's important, Luke, is the way that this is all happening. The way that Jesus and John the Baptist come in. The people that are involved, the words that they say, the role that the angel plays, the way the Holy Spirit is moving. What doesn't matter to Luke is what they behave like as children. The one exception to that coming up in chapter 2. That's not the important part. And the gospel writers are focusing our attention. This is what's most important. Remember Luke in his introduction, and I'd like to spend too much time in opening paragraphs, but Luke in his introduction tells us that he's surveyed a whole bunch of sources, and he's put this together in an orderly fashion so that we, Theophili, the lovers of God, can be informed about the truth. So if you're telling the story and you're looking at all this source material, you're going to sit down and write it in the way that tells people what's most important. You're not going to waste our time with things that don't matter. And so what we can say is when Luke spends 80 verses telling us how Jesus and John the Baptist get on the scene, that's what he thinks is important. In Mark, the first half of the first chapter includes Jesus' coming on the scene as a full-grown man, ready to be baptized and calling disciples. By the time we get to the end of the first chapter of Mark, Jesus is already in Galilee. He's already got people with him. He's already identified the 12. But here Luke spends 79 verses telling us how it is that Jesus came to be. And it's a wonderful gift. Flip over to chapter 2, and we'll carry on with the birth of Jesus. So now, remember the structure that Luke is giving us and his promise that we're going to have an orderly account? So after we get that introductory paragraph, we get the foretelling of the birth of John the Baptist. Then we get the foretelling of the birth of Jesus. Then we get the birth of John the Baptist. And what's next? Birth of Jesus. This is an orderly account. So beginning in chapter 2, and verse 1. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that the whole world should be registered. This was the first registration, and it was taken while Quirinius was the governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, the city of David, called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and the family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged, and who was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. If you happen to have your Luke 1 text out in front of you, you will notice in Luke 1 and 5, in the days of King Herod of Judea. And then over here in 2 and 1, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus. It was the first registration, and it was taken while Quirinius was the governor of Syria. Luke is putting us in an exact historical context. An exact historical context. And in fact, you could, as many scholars have, look back through the records of the Roman Empire and figure out when all of these people were in these various offices and pretty closely spot where the birth of Christ would have fallen in a modern calendar. Why does Luke spend all that time? Remember, he's only going to tell us the things that matter. He's telling us that so that we know it really happened. This isn't a metaphor. This isn't a legend. This is an actual historical event that took place in a specific time and a specific place. What was that time? It was the day when Herod was king of Judea, when Augustus was the emperor, and when Quirinius was the governor of Syria. That's the time that this happened. That exact time. And where did it happen? The WH questions? Where did it happen? Joseph went from Nazareth in Galilee, which is in the north, to Judea, which is the region around Jerusalem, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and the family of David. We know exactly where, we know exactly when, we need not be in doubt that this story is true. That's Luke's point. Early on in my time at Holy Communion, when a new rector comes in, you tend to get meetings where people kind of want to sound you out and sort of figure out where you stand on various issues. And I had someone make an appointment to come and speak with me, an office appointment on the calendar, calling in advance because he had some questions to ask me about important matters. Oh my, all right, so I had my sort of lists out on all of the hot button topics of the day, and what's my response going to be. And he sits down, and after we've had a few minutes of, hello, how are you, he says to me, do you believe that the resurrection is literally true? And I said, I do. He said, great, that's all I wanted to ask. Simple as that. Luke wants us to know this really happened. An actual historical fact in an actual historical time and place. Not a metaphor. If you're writing in your own to that children, please.
The reason he mentions Quirinius is Quirinius was the actual proconsul.
Tell me what that means.
that means he had been a consul in the reign of Augustus, probably serving with Augustus. And he was assigned the province of Syria, which included Jerusalem. And
I gotcha. So Quirinius is the one who's in charge on behalf
yes.
of Rome. So we've got Augustus and Quirinius paired here, and then we've got Herod in the other one. So we've got the hierarchy, right? If you're writing in your, if you're working your own text, you're taking any notes, you'll notice that Luke repeats himself, also an indication that something is important. In verse 5, chapter 2 and verse 5, Luke writes, he, Joseph, went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged. Well, we already know that information. We got that information back in chapter 1 when Gabriel appeared to Mary. But Luke here is underscoring it for us. To whom he was engaged, they're not yet married. Couple of important words here. Bethlehem. Bet is the Hebrew root meaning house. Lehem is bread, house of bread. And you'll recognize that from the stories of Ruth when there was a famine and Ruth and Naomi went for Bethlehem. They went to the house of bread, but there was no bread in the house of bread because there was a famine, and now Jesus is going to Bethlehem. So we've got this connection to his lineage. In Matthew's account, we get the lineage, which includes Ruth, so we get some anchoring here in Bethlehem, but the location is not coincidental at all. And I'd also like to talk about a manger, because if I say manger, image that comes to mind, sort of little thing with the crisscrossed legs that Jesus is laid on hay in, that's fine, not inaccurate. Manger, root word mange, to eat. It's the trough that the food goes in. So let's not stylize it too much. They're in the stable in the back, and it's the trough that the food goes in. Anyone who's been to livestock farms knows that this is not an attractive thing. Spending time with cows and pigs is not something that clean and tidy people do. It's a good place to wear very tall boots and very old clothes. So let's not stylize it too much. Let's not let Renaissance artists clean it up for us. Let's remember this is where the food was, and the cattle are lowing from the hymn. Why are they lowing? Because you're in my food. I was going to eat that, and now you put a child in it. That's why they're lowing, right? So let's not let that get cleaned up too far. Anything else on this? Comments, questions, insights? Liz, please.
Well, I always still just wonder what kind of jerk would not take in a woman that's in the middle of childbirth. But then I wonder, is it because she wasn't married and they were shunning her?
Yeah, so the role of the innkeeper is a really interesting one. And if you read very closely, the innkeeper actually doesn't get a line in the text. It just says there was no room in the inn. We don't know how they found that out. We don't know if the Hilton app told them that there wasn't any place to be had, whatnot. But the innkeeper doesn't get the line. It's just kind of put there by the narrator. But that question is a really critical one. Who would not find room or compassion? Or has this person already taken compassion on all these people and has all these pregnant women lying all over the house? We don't know, but that question is such a good one. Such a good one.
In most inns, there was only one bed,
mm-hmm.
and you know everybody lay across the bed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and only so, one bed to be had.
Yeah, and the
in our crashing at home, the innkeeper is peering inquisitively with a light at the manger, so it sort of embellishes.
Yeah.
The
Let's remember some of the parallel structures that Luke is setting up here. So we've got, he's doing pretty well with this orderly account that he set out to give us. Foretelling of John the Baptist, foretelling of Jesus, birth of John the Baptist, birth of Jesus. Remember that Elizabeth and Mary create parallels as well, right? So Elizabeth is shamed because of reproductive issues. Why? She's too old. She's too old. She's gone through her childbearing years. She has not had a child. Mary is the opposite, right? She is just entering her childbearing years, but she got pregnant too early. So Elizabeth got pregnant too late. Mary got pregnant too early. We have we have people who are old. We have people who are young. We have people who are near the city of Jerusalem. We have people who are out in the country in a city that doesn't even appear on most maps. We have parallels. And then we get the shepherds. And that's going to add some texture to this, right? Because these are women. These are women from within communities. The shepherds are probably men. And they are living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night, it says in verse 8. But let's not let the Renaissance artists stylize the shepherds. Who would be a shepherd?
Shepherd is it's an interesting word. It's used of God being shepherd over his people, but the actual shepherds who deal with unclean animals all day are actually the lowest.
Yeah, so we have somebody who's going to be the lowest person in the social strata. So let's not let the Renaissance inflate them unnecessarily. You know, people in the lowest social position, remember that Moses, when he was on the run from Pharaoh because he had just killed somebody, the only job that he could get was tending the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro. So a murderer on the run, whose father-in-law takes pity on him and says, you can go out in the field and look after the sheep because I love my daughter and I want this to work out okay. That's the only job he could get. So these are not upstanding members of society. They're working with unclean animals in a time when ritual cleanliness and purity was very important. I like to think of these people as these are people who went to the fields because they thought it was the only way that they could support their family. And then they get there and they know real darkness. Real darkness. Not city light pollution darkness. Real darkness. And they hear the animals that would be threatening the flock, and they can't supervise the animals who they know their livelihood depends on them. They probably don't own them. So somebody else owns them. They're out in the field. That's where the bandits go, so they can operate under cover of darkness. They go to the field hoping that they can scratch out a living, and once they get to the field, they'll settle just for survival. That's the people that we're talking about. We had two women in the first chapter who were shamed by their society for reproductive issues, and in the second chapter we're getting people who are the lowest of the low, out in the field, dealing with unclean animals. We have yet to encounter a good and upstanding person, possibly excepting Zechariah. We have yet to meet somebody who would be high on the social ladder. Again, excepting Zechariah. And actually, if we think about that, we've got the women on a spectrum, and then we've got the men on a spectrum, don't we? We have Zechariah, who is a priest in the temple, and we've got the shepherds, who are the lowliest of the low, and then on the women's side, we've got the too old and the too young. All of this whole spectrum, because God is working with the whole of creation. Let's read a little bit more. Luke 2 in verse 8. In that region, I don't need to repeat myself, Luke says, because I've told you exactly where it was. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And the angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors. Notice any parallels? Remember the story of Zechariah? Zechariah goes into the temple. He's in a place by himself. And there an angel appears to him, and he is terrified. Same word. not be afraid. Luke repeats himself to underscore his point. Do not be afraid. Now, fear is going to be the natural reaction. So let's remember our shepherds, working class folk, hoping just to survive, in the darkness, hearing the howls of the coyotes in the distance, hoping that the bandits are not on their way, and then while they're there, a fiery angel from heaven appears. That's going to make me afraid. Terror is the right word to use, and then the angel says, don't be afraid. Set aside all of your understandings of how the world is supposed to work because God's doing something new. And he says here in Luke's gospel, I bring you good news of great joy. Now, if you remember back over in Matthew's gospel, where we don't get this story, I think I told you that last week, that we don't get it in just one place. We only get some of it in Matthew and some of it in Luke. Over in Luke, we get the wise men, the wise people who are coming there and are in search of the child, and we also get Herod, right? King Herod. Why is Herod so intent on searching for the child? Why does he send the wise men? Wants to kill him. He's scared.
Yeah.
He's scared.
And he knows when the star appeared. It was 2 years ago. And here the wise guy's telling him that child has been born, so he kills everybody under two.
Yes. The holy, you get the holy innocents. The news comes to Herod that Jesus has been born, and he is filled with fear. The news comes to the shepherds that Jesus will be born, that Jesus has been born, and they are filled with great joy. Two very different perspectives. But Luke is setting us up with the repeated phrase, do not be afraid, do not be afraid, do not be afraid. This is good news of great joy. Do not be afraid. I bring you good news. When the angels had left them, this is verse 15, and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that's taken place that the Lord has made known to us. And so they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what the shepherds had told them about the child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured these words and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them. We have pondering before, and I thought I had underlined it in my text. Forgive me that. This is not the first time that we've heard pondering in these two chapters. So again, another connection between John the Baptist and Mary. Lisa?
Well, it seems like maybe it's more than once the second time we've heard favor. And who he favors. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And he said that to Mary.
Yeah, this idea that God is extending favors, extending grace. Yes, we're hearing that a lot too.
Zechariah and say this is what's going to happen. But three guys up on a hill and telling them so that they spread the word of this joyful event does not seem like the best public relations move. It seems like you would have chosen someone of more import. You know, you chose a priest who's, you know, everybody's going to believe him. But these three guys that are I'm surprised anyone believed them, obviously. And if that was a test of the faith of the people they told, it just seems like an odd choice.
Sure, it is an odd choice. I would take that in a different direction than you did. So not quite so much in the public relations, how do I get the word out as quickly as possible, but who gets to be the first witness? God chooses the lowly woman to be the first witness. And let's remember too, when we get to the resurrection, in a society that was so patriarchal, so heavily patriarchal, all four gospels have women as the first witnesses of the resurrection. It's not God's intention to say, let's get the word out as quickly as possible. It's God's intention to lift up the lowly and bring down the mighty from their thrones, as Mary said. Vance and then Liz. She ponders Gabriel's greeting. So it's the angel's greeting that she ponders, and then the shepherd's greeting. So the shepherds show up, and they say, we've heard this wonderful thing. And she says, I know. I know. 8 days pass. Amy, please. Oh, and Liz. Excuse me. Amy and Liz.
Joseph are from out of town, you know. So, but here then, other people in that community are going to hear this story from some guys that they have literally known their entire lives and know their background, and maybe that adds to the credibility.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the story is starting to spread against people. Wait a minute, I actually know you, rather than, oh yeah, yeah, sure, nice story you're telling me from your visit from out of town. Let's see if I can grab one more story here just because it's just so lovely. Verse 21, Jesus is named, 8 days pass, same thing happens as with John the Baptist, the requirements of the law are completed, but we don't have a dialogue about naming this time. Perhaps we've already been through this once with John the Baptist, do we really need to get out the chalkboard again? The angel said call him Jesus, so we're going to call him Jesus. But then we get Jesus' presentation in the temple, and we meet some more people whose stories we can move through too rapidly, I think. Chapter 2 and verse 22. When the time came for their purification, according to the law of Moses, they brought him, that is, Mary and Joseph brought Jesus, up to Jerusalem to present it to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the They offered a sacrifice according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. So what we have here in 21 through 24 is a completion of what the law would require. This is what people do when they have babies in this culture and in this tradition. And Mary and Joseph are following the law. They're not breaking out. They're not saying, oh, we're going to do a whole new thing. We're not saying God has abolished all of that. Jesus' teachings on all of that are still forthcoming. Mary and Joseph are doing what you do when you have a baby in first century Palestine. Then we get to meet some new people. And then the circle gets even bigger. 25. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel. And the Holy Spirit, squiggly underlined there, and the Holy Spirit rested on him and rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit, another squiggly line, that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, so three times in one paragraph, Simeon came to the temple, and when parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for the glory of your people Israel. So let's not miss the details of this one. Simeon is a faithful guy. He goes to the temple every day. looking for the Savior, looking for the consolation of Israel, looking for the person who's going to come and make everything right. And every day he goes up to the temple, and every day he comes back disappointed. Now the Holy Spirit, who appears three times in four verses here, has told Simeon something unique. What has the Spirit told Simeon?
You will stand before you die.
Before you die. Or, other side of that, you won't die until you see the Lord's Messiah. Simeon is waiting to die. He is waiting to be released from this Sisyphean journey of going up the mountain, down the mountain, up the mountain, down the mountain. Every day up, every day back. Except one day, when he walks in and he sees Jesus. Note that no words need to be spoken. Mary doesn't have to tell him the story. Just like when she walked into Elizabeth's house, John the Baptist, even in utero, recognizes Jesus. Simeon, too, recognizes Jesus. This is not intellectual assent. This is not persuasion. This is not an argument being crafted or a story being told in a perfect way. No, no, no. This is Jesus showing up. And when Jesus shows up, the Holy Spirit busts out, and it is unmistakable. And then Simeon gives us his song, which we say every time we read the compline prayers, right? And sometimes an evening prayer. And let's remember what this actually means. Lord, your master, you are now dismissing your servant in peace. You have finally given me permission to die. Because the promised Savior is here. When we say that prayer in compline, we are giving God thanks for permission to go to bed. Simeon is giving God thanks for permission to end his life because it is complete. That which he is waiting for has been accomplished. And then Simeon gives us this first hint of a major theme that's going to appear in Luke and Acts. And we get it in verse 32, and I'm going to read it in reverse so that we don't miss the significance of it. You've come for the glory of your people Israel. That makes sense. Promised Messiah, forgiveness of sins, freedom, full life, all of that. You've come for the glory of your people Israel, and as a light of revelation to the Gentiles. Where did those Gentiles come from? Luke is very concerned with the evangelism of the whole world. He is very concerned with the evangelism of Roman soldiers, one who becomes the first Gentile to be baptized, which Phil very kindly led Bible study on a few weeks ago in this room. He wants it to spread. He wants it to go out. And for Luke, Jesus' mission is not limited to the Jewish people. Jesus' mission is for the whole world. And looking around the room and seeing a lot of people who were not here born Jewish, this is good news for us. This is good news for us because it means God isn't just interested in the people for whom he was historically promised. He's interested in all of us. And Simeon gives us the very first hint of that here, which Luke then develops in some pretty significant ways as the gospel and Acts unfold. Liz.
We're jumping ahead a second, but that next verse where it says the child's father and mother were amazed, I've always wondered about that. But maybe, are they amazed at this whole reference to Gentiles? Because, I mean, they knew all the other stuff.
Yeah, I would actually be interested in drilling down on what the Greek word under that means, because sometimes you run into a translator who's trying to convey one thing and doesn't quite capture it in a way that we can hear it. So I want to drill down on that. But taking it just at face value, I'm wondering if they're amazed at the reception. So they know this is going on. They've been told about this, they've heard about it from angels, they've had the experience of the Holy Spirit themselves, but now they're watching other people recognize it. Other people see it. The prophet in the temple has walked in the front door and said, there's the Messiah that I'm waiting for. I could see some amazement in that experience too. Let me read just one little bit more. We're going to need 1 second beyond time, but I wanted to highlight one thing. child's father and mother were amazed, as Liz pointed out, at what was being said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your soul too." There's the prophecy that Meredith was looking for. They know what's going to happen, something really significant and painful. And there was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of great age, having lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshipped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment she came and began to praise God and speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. So now we get two prophets in the temple, recognizing Jesus on sight, not an argument, not a persuasion, not a public relations campaign, just seeing him and knowing. And isn't it interesting that one of them is female? We don't get a lot of female prophets in Scripture. But Luke goes to some length not just to use a female name, but then to describe her as a daughter of Phanuel, lest there be any confusion. So we have two prophets, one male, one female. We have two women, one old, one young. We have several men, one prominent, many of them lowly. And we haven't even gotten out of the temple yet. We haven't heard a word out of Jesus' own mouth yet. But the truth is already starting to push out. The Holy Spirit will not be contained. The Lord Jesus Christ will not be a constitutional monarch. We're getting this spread and this push. If you take Luke to be the second chapter, the second volume of Acts, you get to see it, that thousands upon thousands were added. He gives us that phrase in there. And that day, 5,000 were added. That day, 3,000 were added. That day, whatever it was, it's just these numbers and numbers of people are recognizing Jesus, because the truth of the gospel will not be contained. It will not be contained by cultural shame. It will not be contained people unwilling to tell the story. It will not be contained by people unwilling to hear the story. It will not be contained by the very power of Rome and the threat of death. The Holy Spirit will not be contained. My preaching professor in seminary used to say, "Now when you go into your churches, and you've got everybody there with their candles ready to sing Silent Night on Christmas Eve, you remember there's a shadow of a cross hanging over that manger." Maybe not the most touching thing I need to do on Friday evening with y'all, but the idea is there. That's the point. It's not just that he was born, it's what he was here to do. And that truth will not be contained, and it's the fact that that truth will not be contained that makes him a threat to Rome, that brings on the cross. And then it's the truth of that lack of containment that gives us the resurrection. Even the grave won't contain Jesus. Bill, last word to you.
Is it assumed that all of these early witnesses, like the shepherds and the wise men, were all Jewish, or is it possible that they could have been Gentiles as well?
That is a good question that I don't know the answer to. What Bill was saying is, are all the people that we've met necessarily Jewish? And certainly Elizabeth and Zechariah and Mary and Joseph and Anna and Simeon are all Jewish. The shepherds, I don't know, and I need to look that up.
Well, they said, "Unto you is born this day in the city of David," and they knew instantly it was Bethlehem.
So. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know that.
Yeah. Yeah, that we could make an argument on that. I love this story. Greatest story ever told, indeed. And you're going to see it even greater told this coming Friday night at 4 when we get the kids involved. So if you haven't seen the Christmas pageant at Holy Communion, you have not seen Christmas the way it's meant to be done. We are going to take 2 weeks off from Forum. We are not taking any time off from church. So next Sunday, the day after Christmas, we will be here at 8, 10:30, and 5:30. We've got a baptism lined up for 10:30. But we'll be off for Forum for 2 weeks, and we'll reconvene on the Sunday after Epiphany. I believe it's the 9th, plus or minus a day. And Mr. Mathis will be here looking at the Epiphany and poetry. It's going to be a wonderful class. So 2 weeks off from Forum, no weeks off from church, Christmas Eve on Friday, Christmas Day on Saturday, a blessed Advent, and an early Merry Christmas to all of you. Church starts in 10 minutes.